Monday morning, and the families of Australia are waking to another day of work, school, sport, and the business of living. When I was growing up in Asia, we looked to the West for all that was inspiring. A broad education, free thought, big shiny cities, passionate democracy, walking on the moon, liberated sex, liberating drugs, and libelous rock and roll. Truly awesome to behold. And this is life in the Western world today. We're told we're richer, healthier, smarter, and happier than ever before. Are we? In this modern world where cars think for you while you dream of winning lotto,
next right.
Why are we all working longer and harder to earn more, to pay for more?
What I want to know is this as good as it gets?
History is about the rise, influence, and fall of civilizations. Most recently, the Egyptians, Greeks, and Romans. After a defined period of progress, they eventually succumbed to self-indulgence and moral decay. The Judeo-Christian West has been the preeminent civilization for the past 2,000 years.
Today, North America, Europe, Australia, New Zealand, and Japan are advanced liberal democracies that the rest of the world aspires to.
But there's a brewing anxiety amidst this abundance. We have rising rates of divorce, infertility, drug dependency, debt, and job insecurity, not to mention terrorism and a new crusade. Where is that boundless, gracious West that I aspired to?
I think we're completely lost. I think people know that they're living lives that aren't deeply satisfying, aren't deeply fulfilling. And I think that's why we have such escalating rates of depression.
We in Australia are looking at about 800,000 people a year who are suffering from a depressive illness. The suicide rate is twice that of the number that die on the roads each year. So 8 or 9 Australians a day die by their own hand. So the figures are very serious.
We're in a situation where the economy is up, but our moral state is in decline. We did a study which revealed that a third of Australians are taking medications or some other drugs for their psychological well-being. I mean, if economic growth and affluence is so good for us, why are so many people unhappy?
The West has endured a library of revolutions and wars to settle on values that have promoted social obligation and self-restraint, while discouraging self-indulgence and antisocial behaviour. Our sense of well-being is based on living decent lives together. Our virtues embrace faith, hope and charity, while our vices typically lurk within schadenfreude, sloth and envy. What does remain at the glittering heart of Western life is freedom. Freedom to think, to speak, to live as you wish, underwritten by law.
One of the really interesting things about our situation is that liberalism has really been about defending the individual and his or her freedom against the encroachment of the church and the state. Neoliberals equate the freedom of the individual with the freedom of the market, but the market has much more influence on our lives today than does the state and the church, I think.
But are we really free individuals in a free market? In this era of mindless consumption, in which the word no does not exist, offering debt without discipline, do we have the ability to control the market anymore?
I mean, after 9/11, both the mayor of New York and the president of the United States came out and said, it's your duty to get out and shop. Robert Reich wrote an editorial saying, since when did it become an American duty to shop? But really, our economy depends on us shopping in this manic kind of way in order to keep it operating at this extraordinary level.
To market to buy a fat pig is now an end in itself. Nothing less, but always something more. Our governments tell us that in order to grow, the market needs more freedom. That means anything goes when it involves a profit. Accountability, rules, regulations, the environment, all out, including jobs. In the name of globalization, the market demands that we send our jobs to cheaper countries, leaving us to upskill at the local TAFE, which will close soon enough because of the skills shortage. And that freedom of speech that we cherish so much in the West? Well, try and say this.
James Hardy, Monsanto, is and Kentucky Fried Chicken, practice. Yeah, sure, I can say that.
The market has turned from slave to master. Everybody having lots of fun and making lots of money. Thanks to technological innovation and cradle-to-grave advertising, we have to consume more just to keep up.
The constant pressure to
upgrade to something that's obsolete in a couple of weeks.
Paying banks to keep our money, ripped off by reams of fine print. We're moving so fast that we don't know what we're leaving behind. I'm not talking about nostalgia for the good old days, but a disconnection from each other, to work without play.
Have a lovely day, dear.
A life spent on the monetary treadmill without leisure to enjoy what remains of the things that make the West the best. I want more time than my lunch hour to fish, and a three-day weekend to walk the dog and throttle the weeds. No, all we do now is work and spend all the way to the grave. And increasingly during this fortunate life, you run alone, Jack. That's what our betters tell us, from business to politics to church, because we're all in it for ourselves.
The market promised us more freedom, more choice, more control over our lives. There's now a wealth of evidence that most people in Australia are more inclined to believe that their lives are controlled by external forces. Fewer people today believe that they have self-control, that they control their own lives. So in a world of the market, ironically, most people feel they don't have freedom. They don't choose the path of their own lives.
Meaningless lives in a material world. Why? Because we want more. We've been hijacked by the market, fed a high finance diet and sold an economic lie.
This is the West at its best. But are we victims of a cultural fraud?
Cultures are created to bring order and meaning to our lives. Of all species, we alone require cultures to give us reasons to live, to make life worth living. When cultures do that poorly, then problems arise. We've created, in a way that was never possible before in history, this sort of false reality built around marketing and consumerism that really isn't in touch with what's most important in being human. And I think this is why I see it, in a sense, as fraudulent. It's not doing what cultures are supposed to do, which is to allow us to understand the world and our place in it.
Australians have always worked hard, but now we work longer than anyone else. At an average of 44 hours a week, we work more than the super-efficient Germans, the can-do Americans, and the salarymen Japanese. The French, in 2001, reduced the working week to 35 hours.
When it was first introduced, of course, we were all told that the sky would fall, that one country cannot do this because it will ruin their competitiveness. It will make them an international basket case. But of course, despite all the predictions, France is still one of the richest countries in the world, and French people still have one of the highest standards of living in the world. Unfortunately, the political pressure to abandon or to limit the 35-hour week is already in place. But that argument is a political argument.
So while they are trying to reclaim a life outside work, we start before we even get there and continue long into the night. What a jip.
People in Europe see wealth as a way to fund working less hours. In Australia, we see working long hours as a path to wealth. Australia is a rich country. Most people in Australia have no difficulty meeting their material needs at all. So the economic imperative for working long hours is not there. It's just a personal preference for more imported cars and televisions and less time with our family and friends.
Indeed, what we want is now more than what we need. 62% of Australians believe that they can't afford to buy everything they really need, including nearly half of households earning over $70,000 a year. The market creates that need.
30, 40 years ago, luxury was something that was confined to the very wealthy. But nowadays, we have seen a process, the so-called democratisation of luxury, where ordinary people are told, why shouldn't you have some luxury? You've earned it. You deserve it. You don't have to be filthy rich to enjoy luxury. And so you can buy, you know, some Louis Vuitton personal good for, you know, $50, $60, $100 and feel as though you can have a bit of luxury. You can buy a Mercedes for $50,000. I mean, pretty much anyone in Australia, if they want it enough, can buy a Mercedes.
We certainly wouldn't exist in Australia if the market was not here. And increasingly, Australian women travel. They are exposed to luxury goods. Carl creates clothes for the weekend, for skiing, for cross-country, for equestrian, for a little skirt and coat for the office. It's a very broad collection. It's a recognition that we all have multifaceted lives. And women are prepared to pay for those clothes. They're prepared to pay for beautiful quality that lasts. You know that the codes, that the messages that Chanel jacket is sending out transmit something very positive about you, the wearer.
We're led to believe that money gives us choice, status, and increasingly, an identity. But there's something hollow about all this. Whose meaning or identity is it? Am I really defined by where I live, what I wear, eat, or drive, or am I just another willing victim of our sophisticated market?
Even though our incomes have been growing rapidly for a long time, our expectations have been growing even more. So how do we meet the difference between our incomes and our higher expectations? We borrow.
American tycoon Nelson Rockefeller was reportedly asked, "How much money does a man need to be happy?" He replied, "Just a little more." Not long ago, we called it debt, and it was to be avoided. These days, it's called credit, and it's eagerly sold. What a con. But when and where did our attitudes start to change?
America invented the credit card in 1950. We invented the modern fast food restaurant in 1955, the modern cruise ship, the Walt Disney World, the Las Vegas Casino Hotel, on and on and on. They're all American inventions that are obviously consumer-oriented, but also have been exported to the rest of the world. Clearly, the religion that Americans are practicing these days, and many other people around the world are practicing now, is consumption. And I think the mall has similarities to a cathedral. I call it a cathedral of consumption. And people go there to kind of worship the consumption god. They're shaped remarkably like churches, that they have a kind of cross-like structure, and they're large, and they're designed to awe of the visitor. There are these great experts who design these structures and design them in order to manipulate consumers into doing what the Cathedral of Consumption wants them to do.
Defrauded by our betters. Without doubt, America is the world's leading economic, military, and cultural force. But what can we say about its confused values? As the ultimate free society grapples with creeping double standards, millionaire politics, and bald self-interest.
By serving our ideals, we also serve our interests.
There's great pressure on people to consume, and great concern in the stock market, for example, about something like Consumer Confidence Index, which never used to be a big concern. You know, it was always production measures. Now, those are less important to the American stock market. What's much more important is the Consumer Confidence Index, because that's really the motor for the United States. And it's a motor that the United States has exported to the rest of the world. They want the rest of the world to consume like the United States, because after all, we invented all of these things that keep this world of consumption going.
Where is the meaning in this American world that we ape in Australia? We subscribe to their outdated economic orthodoxies that spread the social gaps.
Keep on dreaming the things you want to be.
We wallow in America's vacuous idolization of celebrity.
Never in the history of the world has any civilization produced entertainers at its apex. Entertainers, court jesters, they were always in the spare time. You know, the famous people were thinkers, military men, writers. No one can remember a single actor or actress of even 100 years ago, with the exception of John Wilkes Booth, who became famous because he shot Abraham Lincoln. But aside from that, we remember Shakespeare, the playwright, not the people who acted the plays. Today, who the heck's ever heard of the playwrights? We've heard of the actor who memorizes the lines.
And this superficial carpet ride is rolled out by an increasingly lowbrow media offering banality, vulgar voyeurism, and more ads. We're no longer able to distinguish between quality and kitsch, a descent into a junk culture.
Thank you.
It's the great McDonaldization of society. And, like a burger, it's initially filling, but ultimately leaves you a little unsatisfied. Coming soon to a piece of real estate near you.
The principles of the fast food restaurant are coming to organize more and more sectors of society and more parts of the world. So it's a very influential development going back to the origins of McDonald's in about 1955. And those principles are things like efficiency. Everything has to, you know, it reduces eating to a very efficient kind of operation. Predictability, everything has to be the same from one time and place to another time and place. Calculability, emphasis on quantifiable things, so it's the Big Mac, not the Delicious Mac. So these kinds of principles, efficiency, predictability, calculability, have spread out from the U.S. around the world and from the fast food industry to churches and colleges and politics and you name it. These are highly rational systems that produce all sorts of irrationalities, dehumanizing kinds of settings, settings without magic or mystery. So you have this erosion of diversity, this homogenization of the world, and I think we lose something in the process.
Our mindless pursuit of money alone is dehumanizing us, turning us into profit people who seek value in the invaluable, who reduce the brilliant color and flawed spectacle of that Wild West that I love. Novelist Walker Percy was asked what concerned him most about the future of America. He answered, "Probably the fear of seeing America, with all its great strength and beauty and freedom, gradually subside into decay through default and be defeated, not by the communist movement, but from within, by weariness, boredom, cynicism, greed, and in the end, helplessness before its great problems. Not far behind will be little old Australia."
We're a terribly wasteful society. If you look at the United States of America, and Australia seems to follow their example, the United States has 5% of the world's population and it is consuming 25% of the oil mined every year. I mean, that's just not reasonable. And I see the environment as being the absolute primary issue. It's at the base of all things. And when I look at environmental problems, even here today, and I put the reasons for degradation, environmental degradation, I get to two basic reasons, greed and ignorance. Now, ignorance we can educate for. Greed is more difficult. It is the greatest threat to this world. I mean, global terrorism is a huge threat, but it is nowhere near the threat of climate change. And if you thought the tsunami disaster was horrifying, as it was, we'd better get ready for it, because there are going to be more natural disasters by way of flood, cyclone, mudslide, and other natural disasters. It's going to happen. And we are going to lose, essentially, millions and millions of people over the next 50 years because of the fault of humanity, and particularly the fault of Western humanity.
As we continue to consume without consequence, we risk junking the things that make the West a dignified place to be.
We appear to be entering either a new Renaissance or a new Dark Age, and at this stage the evidence is not really clear which way we'll go.
And we've nearly given up on God as a guide. We've replaced a complex search for the divine with a mundane pursuit of the worldly.
I think we've shifted from what we have to what we don't have. And I think that's partly the commercialism. You know, you sit and watch television and they tell you that you need this and you need that. It's a loss of religion. I remember being at Sunday school and you'd sing a little ditty, you know, count your blessings. We don't do that anymore. You don't get that sense of, I'm so lucky.
We can measure economic growth, but how do you measure goodness or virtue?
William Bennett was Reagan's education secretary, who went on to write and lecture on virtues while allegedly practicing a vice, gambling. But he wrote, "If we have full employment and growth, if we have cities of gold and alabaster, but we have children who haven't learned how to walk in goodness, justice and mercy, then the Western ideal, no matter how gilded, will have failed."
In its
In its essence, the reason why sex is so pleasurable is that it makes you feel intensely alive. For most people today, sex does the exact opposite. You know, people have sex in order to fall asleep, in order to purge their bodies of tension. So I think we've really lost that sacred connection. We're screwed.